Musical Talk, the UK independent musical theatre podcast.
Hello, welcome to this week's episode of Musical Talk. My name is Nick Hudson. I sat down with Thos to discuss my thoughts on The Girls, which is playing at the Phoenix Theatre. And then I had a chat to The Girls, which you'll hear also in this episode. And then we'll end the episode with one of Gary Barlow's demo recordings for the opening number of The Girls, Yorkshire. Enjoy! I've been to see The Girls at the very, very charming Phoenix Theatre in London's West End, and I'm here with London's Thomas Ribbits. Hello.
Hello, London's Nick. I'm fine, thank you very much indeed. Phoenix Theatre, first thing comes to mind for you?
Harry Potter.
Oh, really? Not Blood Brothers?
Oh, yes, that also.
Or for me, Noel Coward's Tonight at 8.30 in the 1930s.
5 seconds and you've mentioned Noel Coward.
Absolutely. Well, I'm sorry.
Hello, darling.
I'm sorry it took so long. But the Phoenix has a great... It's a beautiful theatre, isn't it? And it's had some really great musicals in it in the past.
And the auditorium is a lot bigger than you think it is.
Yes, because it's quite petite on the outside. It's a nice... Is it 20th theatre? It's certainly, certainly a 20th century theatre, isn't it?
It has a gentleman's club as well.
Is there where? In the theatre?
Underneath the theatre, the Phoenix Arts Club.
It's a bit where Phantom Tim of the Opera, isn't it?
Where Tim and I recorded an interview there about some musical about a magic bus or something, I seem to remember, for children's musicals.
Oh, that was a good few years ago on Musical Talk, wasn't it?
It was.
But it's not an institute, is it? It's a club.
Yes.
Not the Women's Institute.
No.
Do you see what I did there?
I saw what you did, and I'm...
But, what an unsubtle gear change that was.
I saw what you baked there. Now put your clothes back on. I went to see The Girls. Thos, you haven't seen The Girls.
No, I haven't.
Have you seen anything to do with The Girls? Either the play or the film, or were you there at the original moment in Yorkshire?
Well, I think, yes. I think we ought to clarify immediately by The Girls. We're talking about the new musical adaptation of Calendar Girls, which is a tremendously well-known British story from, say, the last 20 years or so. I have seen a tremendously enjoyable play version of it, and years ago I'm sure I saw the film. Like a lot of things, certainly a lot of...
The T-shirt will be next.
Well, I'm not sure I wear sloppy joes or undergarments, but I do wear undergarments, I just don't wear them logoed with musicals on. But taking us back to the point, Calendar Girls has got a really great British recognition factor. Even people who have not necessarily seen the film or the play know the story because it's had press coverage as well, and it's a generally uplifting story with a bit of comedy, a bit of pathos. It's been developed into lots of different things. I like it as a story. So I suppose I do have a question for you. Why do you think they've gone for the title The Girls rather than Calendar Girls? Doesn't this break George Stiles' rule about letting a show sell itself?
I don't know. I guess that will be one of the questions we'll have to ask the girls themselves.
Because you will be talking to some people, I think.
Yes, hopefully in this episode you will hear a chat I had with the stars of this musical.
The girls, in fact.
A plot point I only realised today was 7 girls, but 12 months in the calendar. And they only take 7 photos, so I don't know how that works in the grand scheme of things.
Well, now, do you know, that's interesting. I'd never stopped to think of that. Maybe there were other girls who were not really in the story, because can you imagine, just from a narrative point of view...
How long the musical would be.
Well, yes, but you can't really compute 12 characters, do you? So for presumably, I mean, let's talk nuts and bolts. Actually, dramaturgically, there may well have been 12 or more. I mean, the Women's Institute was bound to have had many, many more members than just these.
And it's a very, very lovely story, very moving. But the interesting thing was... going to see it.
Yeah.
I'd never seen the film. I'd never seen the play.
Oh, you were.
So this was my first experience with the girls.
So can I ask, you were a virgin before you met the girls?
Yes.
How interesting.
And I saw everything you could ever wish to see of them.
I imagine you did. Baps included, I'm thinking. Yes. Or was it buns? I can't remember. Now, that's very interesting. So you actually did come to it fresh. So I suppose I need to ask you the question. The first question is, did you enjoy it?
I did. It's very, very, very funny. Gary Barlow has written it with Tim Firth. Now, they're very vague about who's done what, because very recently I've discovered that Tim Firth himself is a composer.
Oh, right.
And he's a jolly good lyricist as well, from what I was able to hear. And I went to his website, and he's written comedy songs and things. So it kind of messed with my mind, because I went in thinking, well, Gary Barlow's done the music, so it's going to be kind of pop. And it wasn't. So I don't know who's done what.
Well, maybe it's one of those great fusions, because if they can both do both, then actually there's nothing stopping them sending a song. I don't know how they do this, but it might be that someone wrote that song and someone else wrote this song, and they divide it up between them, or more likely, They sent songs to each other, made suggestions, made improvements.
From what I read, Gary Barlow did very basic outlines for the songs, and Tim Firth took them, did the playwrighty thing of actually making them work within the dramatic structure,
within a musical,
possibly adding lyrics, possibly taking a bit of a song here and putting it there, and you know, doing the hard work.
Well, you say that, but I mean, forgive me, Gary Barlow is no slouch in the songwriting department. You know, forgive me, he is a generationally younger Elton John, and Elton John managed to work it out rather nicely when he did Billy Elliot, still on tour.
But that was done the same way. Elton John boasts that he wrote Billy Elliot in 2 weeks.
But someone else helped.
It then took a year for the team to put the songs, to make them work on stage.
But this is a trend I think we're seeing quite a lot of in British theatre anyway, aren't we? Because the show that we always like to talk about, which is I Can't Sing, now fading into memory, but living strongly in my heart.
I can't remember.
Harry Hill apparently wrote the story relatively quickly, I think, and then other people came in and helped musicalise it.
But so, Steve Brown is a proper musical theatre composer.
Yes, Spend
is a triumph.
Yeah. Oh, I couldn't agree more. In fact, I actually think I Can't Sing is a triumph as well.
Yes.
So I'm not in any way criticising this, but actually it's a perfectly now well-established thing that one or two of the contributors to a British musical, or it doesn't have to be a musical, but a British musical is a good thing, what we're talking about, only bring to the table necessarily what they are famous for bringing to. And there's almost like a team of crack musical experts who then take that raw material and whatever has been inspired from it and by it and makes a musical out of it.
Musicurgs, I guess we could call them.
We could.
Musicurgs.
I'm not... Oh, you see.
Dramaturgs and musicurgs.
Well done on trying to coin a phrase. Whether it catches on, Nick, I wouldn't like to say, but I'm not going to be buying the new
How's
Oxford English Dictionary.
How's clackism working out for you, Thos?
It's receded into history like my hair. But seriously, you know, I think it's perfectly reasonable that, you know, a musical is a very expensive option for anyone, any producer. You want to make it as good as it can be, so you're going to take people who know how to write musicals and hone musicals and improve and produce. But at the same time, you also want that iconoclastic individuality that comes from someone like a Harry Hill or a Gary Barlow or an Elton John. They will bring something to the table that wouldn't necessarily have been there before. So in fact,
marketing material, most importantly.
Well, their names won't hurt.
No.
Gary Barlow is the name I associate with the girls from the publicity I've seen. It's interesting that Tim Firth is involved, and he's a very talented man as well. But Gary Barlow will be, I think, to the man in the street, the name that
he's
will stick out.
He's the public face, isn't he?
He is indeed, but he's worked for it. You know, whatever one thinks, whether one likes his music or not, he's a very successful composer, and my word, he's done his time. He's, you know, he's been around for, what, 20, 25 years now? Mm. And he's still a name, i.e. he's not faded.
This is going to sound grammatically terrible. The girls was on the Royal Variety Performance and Gary Barlow was singing and Tim Firth was playing the piano. That's what put into my mind who's actually done what in this musical. But it's very, very successfully done. I think whoever's done it has done it very well. And Tim Firth was directing. So, obviously, massive theatrical talent.
Oh, indeed. And, of course, he'll also, because he's doing so much and has so many connections with it, that allows people to smooth over the edges as well. You know, he'll know how to fuse it all into a lovely, smooth outcome. So, what's the score entertaining? Did you enjoy it? You said the show was funny. That's the first word you used. So, it's tonally funny first, although it presumably does still have pathos.
Absolutely. There's
a little bit of heart.
There's very moving moments towards the end, which I won't reveal.
No.
But
it needs that little bit of salt, doesn't it?
Yes. It's kind of bawdy humour because it is about people kind of getting their kit off and stuff, so it does have that.
And people you might not think would as well.
No.
Yes. There's a bit of class there as well, isn't there?
Yes. It's about the elderly generation kind of expressing themselves, which is really, really wonderful.
Let it all hang or fall out.
Yes. Musically, it's very British, which is nice, because even though Gary Barlow is from Lancashire, don't tell anyone from Yorkshire that, does have that kind of Julian Knott's Wallace and Gromit feel to it, obviously without not being jokey. But then it kind of breaks into random swing at some points where there's a song in it where they're bored of singing Christmas carols in the WI, so they sing a kind of a very cleverly titled Who Needs a Silent Night,
where they kind of do
a kind of big swing number. The issue I had is that the band in the pit wasn't a jazz band, so there's a lot of synth stuff going on, and it kind of felt a bit mushy, but the lyrics really stood out. I can't remember any of them because there's so many flung at you, but there's some very, very witty rhymes there.
Good professional
stuff. I've long held the flag that I'll be kind of
generic here, pop songwriters can't write musical theatre.
Mm.
I think this is where Tim Firth probably did come in very handy, is that the songs do really, really what they need to. It has been a week since I've seen it, and I don't have a programme with me, so my memory of it is a bit vague, but I remember enjoying it very, very much, laughing, and I did get a big lump in my throat at the end. It was just...
Was that from the Women's Institute cake stall? Or
yes.
Or you talking emotionally?
Emotionally.
Oh, lovely.
Certainly a musical to go and see. The cast are phenomenal, and what's really nice is to see a kind of role that's often shoved into the background in musical, which is not the elderly woman, but that kind of middle-aged to elderly role.
They're not young ingenue characters. They are middle-aged at least. Yes, it's women of a certain age is the old-fashioned phrase, isn't it?
Joanna Riding plays the lead character, whose name I can't remember because I don't have a programme in front of me. Astonishing. Claire Moore is astonishing. Sophie Louise Dan is always astonishing in everything she does. She has a very, very good song about having work done. And it's just an absolute joy.
But isn't that interesting? Because suddenly, London is full of musicals, or at least well, I say full, but suddenly the London musical stage has a number of opportunities for a large number of women of a certain age, because Stepping Out is also coming to London.
But Tamsin Athwaite has stepped out of Stepping Out.
Actually, oh, I'm sorry to hear that. But even so, that is still a show that is principally a middle-aged female cast with one idiot man. That is basically how it works, isn't it?
Yeah.
And possibly, I can't remember, no, even The Pianist is a woman, isn't it? It was Shelley Winters in the film, I think. Gosh, casting my mind back, the Liza Minnelli film, which was awfully good a few years ago, and it was a few years ago now. That's been advertised by having ladies dancing on a keyboard in a spangly, jazz-handsy kind of way on the posters.
Sister Act is sort of coming back as well.
Oh, is it now?
Yeah.
Well, there you are then. Isn't that interesting? But suddenly, this is a fantastic thing, and I hope it lasts, although I doubt it will, but, you know, there's a sudden spread of good female roles. And all of them, interestingly, are collective pieces, by which I mean there's no star vehicle. They are all, you know, it's a group of
ensemble
seven.
Ensemble
pieces. An ensemble piece, absolutely, yes.
So if you were to go see the musical of the girls, and I hope you do, Thos, what would you, as someone more knowledgeable of the other media...
Having seen it in its other formats, yes.
What would you like to see in a musical?
In it as a musical? Well, I can... Let me recast that question ever so slightly. I can ab...
Theatre people.
Darling, listen. seriously, I can see why it's been an ideal choice for a musical, because actually, for the reasons you've already spotted, funnily enough, from the interpretation you've given me, but it is a good British story with a lot of comedy, because actually, we like... And on the whole, we want...
We like laughing at ourselves, and that's what the musical does very well.
And we want a lot of laughter, but we also like a bit of class laughter, because, you know, from my recollection, there's different classes represented in the Women's Institute and amongst the seven women. So there's a bit of friction there. But, you know, we recognise class in this country, and you can't escape it. For better or for worse, it's there and we understand it. So that makes it very distinctively British. So I'd expect that. It does, as you quite rightly say, have a heart-tugging moment. Mm-hmm. You know, so there is a good dollop of pathos, genuine, sincere emotion in it. You know, which you need. You need just enough salt in your caramel to make it a delicious dessert. So I can absolutely see why it's been picked. It's also got good household recognition, or it would have if it was called Calendar Girls. I wonder if it's ever going to be called the Calendar Girls musical at some stage for advertising purposes, because I regret, and I think they're missing a trick by not calling it Calendar Girls.
Maybe there was a rights situation that someone possibly. Else holds the theatrical rights of Calendar Girls and they had to look at the title, I don't know.
Or maybe they just want to say it is a new piece, this. It's an interpretation, but it's a new piece. So I'm not criticising that, but I'm just saying that Calendar Girls is such a famous British story now within Britain. And of course, it falls into that category also of an adaptation of what I call a British successful film. What I think of as the white poster films, ever since Four Weddings and a Funeral and those comedies that came out, Love Actuary.
Love Actuary people.
Yes, a lot of accountants falling in love. It's a marvellous film. You have to, unfortunately, it's ruined by the double entry sequence in the bookkeeping. You know, there's a kind of brand of a particular British film once again, for better or for worse, which I think of as a white poster with pictures on it. So it's something about...
Often written by Richard Curtis.
Often, not always, but yes, that's exactly true. But it's quite a canon of those, and most of them have a very... Yeah, fun enough, Made in Dagenham is a good example of that. It's a white poster British film that has comedy and pathos in it. I enjoyed that when I saw it, by the way, Made in Dagenham. I saw it in the last couple of weeks, but it wasn't a success. I hope that The Girls will be. It has, I think, a slightly stronger, more rounded story. I think the profile of the story is a very good profile for any adaptation into drama.
The seven leads is...
The dwarves, yes.
Yeah.
Oh, no, that's a different musical, isn't it? Yes. How did Grumpy do?
They represent the target audience of musical theatre in this country very well, I think.
How do you mean? I'm genuinely interested in that.
Well, generally looking around...
How many teenage girls and gay men are there?
Looking around the theatre, there was mostly women of a certain age.
Yeah, of course. The ladies who lunch.
Yeah, the gay men and the teenagers thing, they have other musicals to go and see. But what's nice about this show is it's not in your face camp.
No.
It's not about teenage angst. Yes, there is a new teenage love interest added to the musical, which has a very, very... funny moment about talking about hand jobs and at the same time the guy's playing a tug of war, which always speaks for itself.
What muscular hand you have, Grandma.
But generally the audience are there to see people they can relate with on stage.
And it's entirely right that they should have... Oh, that sounds so patronising, but it's entirely right that all British sectors of theatre-going society should see themselves reflected on stage. By the way, it's interesting you say that the gay men and teenage girls... You know, they are it's a shorthand for a particular clientele that goes to see musicals, and it's absolutely correct. But I'm sure that many of them will come to this if it's a success, and I jolly well hope it is. Certainly, it's very much a case of, yes, I am actually very interested in seeing this. I'm intrigued, pleased that it's been done. And also, I must say, you know, a few years ago, I might have been a bit sniffy or a bit cautious about seeing the name Gary Barlow attached to it, in the same way I was a bit cautious and a bit sniffy about seeing Elton John's name attached to Billy Elliot. I used the two as, you know, I think they're an interesting pair or set of bookends in terms of British musicals. And yet, Billy Elliot was tremendously good. Mm. And I thought...
But was the music tremendously good, or was the taking of the melodies and placing, as we mentioned earlier...
I think we might be falling into the trap of thinking of musicals in the Gershwin model, for example. When you go and see Lady Be Good, you're going to see the Gershwin songs. You'll enjoy the plot, but it doesn't mean anything. But we no longer, any of us, think about musicals. Well, I suppose Sondheim actually does. I'm thinking as we talk. But when you see a Sondheim musical, you're doing the same thing. You actually, although you will expect a sophisticated piece of drama, we all know that if it wasn't a Sondheim score, half the people at that musical wouldn't be seeing it. So you do go and see Sondheim. So there's still the tradition of the cult of the songwriter. But there is a very strong alternative tradition, which is actually, and it's probably healthier, which is actually that the score is just one element of a musical, along with a good book, along with a good set of lyrics, along with, you know, good direction.
But then there are people that say music, they're called musicals, so yeah, it should all be about the music, and the music is bad, it's a bad musical.
I agree with that, but in the same way that if the book is awful, I mean, we criticise Gershwin books, but actually they're very successful in what they're trying to be, which is a piece of entertaining fluff.
To support the songs.
If you went to see a Sondheim show and the book was diabolical, it would still be a great Sondheim show, but it wouldn't be a good show. Sweeney Todd holds itself up, I think. I mean, Edward Bond made that a good play before it became a musical.
Christopher Bond did a better job, though.
Is it Christopher Bond?
Yeah.
I thought it was Edward Bond. No. I do apologise. My word was my Bond, but I'm now my word apparently is wrong. Sweeney Todd is a piece of melodramatic hokum, but yes, it's got genuine blood and guts in it, funnily enough. I mean, emotionally, it's a meaty piece. Once again, all these are inadvertent statements. It's not rubbish. I'm just trying to think of a show. The problem is the shows that don't have good books disappear. I actually think that you can't write a good show unless you've got a good book, and then you can fail because you haven't got a good score and you haven't got a good actor and you haven't got this and the other. I think the narrative has always got to come first. I'm delighted that we know that the narrative in this, unless they've done something remarkably odd, will be good because it's a tried and tested story. So it can only succeed on its book, and it's got that. then one hopes the score will be good, and I'm sure the performances will all be fantastic, etc., etc. So everything about it, the auspices are awfully good, I think.
Yes, I'm going to pretend I know what that word means. Do go and see it, because I think it's right up your street, Thos.
Yes.
It's just very moving. Should we see what the girls themselves
have to say? Absolutely.
I'm
delighted to hear them.
Hi there, I'm Claire Moore, and I'm playing Chris.
Sophie Louise Dan, and I'm playing Celia.
And I'm Nick Hudson, and I'm sat on, not on top of these girls, but I'm in this, practically, and we're talking about The Girls, which is a brilliant new musical written by Tim Firth and Gary Barlow, playing at the Phoenix Theatre in London's glorious Charing Cross Road, and I thought we'd sit down and talk to two of the seven girls, which is a wonderful ensemble.
Well, we're sort of six girl girls.
Yes.
And then there's two other girl girls. And yes. Then there's the buddy girl girl.
Yeah. So, but we are a unit of six, really, and that's how we've been recognised.
And Olivier Award.
There you go. I wasn't nominated. Say it, but
I know. I can't believe it. We've just come back from the
Posh Lovers Day.
It's been such an exciting day.
And frocks and all sorts.
And interviews. And what seems to have been special about today is that, you know, I think it's pretty rare to have a group of anybody being nominated for awards, but a group of, let's say, over 40s, and then some. Anyway, go on. You.
The last group was a very young group of ladies, so it's nice that you're representing the.
It's lovely. We're so often invisible. Yes. Or we play nanas or mums or maids or something.
And that's what struck me about the show immediately was there, and we talk about this in our review, is there's now a show with six roles for, and we use the term very politely, women of a certain age, which is
absolutely so rare
in the West End now, isn't it?
Is.
And certain shapes and sizes. You know, we are not representing the beautiful, perfect woman or body image. We are ordinary women, and it's a celebration of being ordinary and the friendships, and that's what makes it extraordinary.
Absolutely. Well, I keep using that hook, you know, and we're representing a group of real ladies, ordinary ladies, who did something extraordinary.
It's true, and that's in the programme. I mean, there's no other way of describing them, though, because they were an ordinary bunch of ladies from Yorkshire who did something extraordinary, as you say, and are so inspirational.
And they're still around, which...
They are not only around, but they have become really... Yeah, and they've become really good friends.
Lovely
they've
friends.
Been so much fun to be around. Their stories, and they feel that this is the truest representation of their relationship and how the calendar was made, which is brilliant.
Yeah.
Because it has been a film and a play, and now a musical. Mm-hmm. It's in the T-shirt, and possibly the calendar will be next.
Who knows? Watch this space.
We're wondering why the name changed. Was it to distance itself from the previous media? Or?
I don't know. It may be. I'm not sure.
No, I can't quote it, but I think it might be something to do with copyright.
May well be. That would be my
Although
guess.
It is definitely Tim's baby. And But as I understand it, what people are really enjoying about this incarnation is how the denouement is the photo shoot and the success of the fundraising, if you will.
Because that was what they set out to achieve.
That's what they did.
I just got a shiver down my spine as you said that moment, because it was so
there
lovely.
You go.
Oh, well,
there
it's great, and it's right that it ends the show. It then becomes a real celebration of their achievements, and that's how they want to be remembered, and how they want the memory of John Baker, who was the man who lost his life to cancer and started all this off. They want that to be a positive thing for all of them, because Angela, his widow, still has to live with that memory of losing her husband, even though they are very much part of this and celebrate along with us. But, you know, we still have to remember he was a real person and his family got left behind. And and it's always very special. And so to finish on something so positive is wonderful, isn't it?
And just to get that reaction
every night.
And that's how I'll remember the piece, because I hadn't seen the play or the film.
Okay,
so my first
great.
Exposure...
Oh, great. I haven't seen the play. I've seen the film.
Yeah.
Did you get to meet the girls when you were preparing for the roles? Did you
I'm the newbie in the group. I'm delighted to be on board.
You know
me and new work anyway. And
we know about that, don't we?
Yeah, we do. And we're flying that flag. Yeah. And it was just a treat again to meet these wonderful ladies, and they've sort of. Because I think Celia, in all honesty, is a bit of a conglomeration of a couple of them. Mm-hmm. I think it's lovely. Chris, isn't it? Who's really quite twinkly. She's absolutely lovely, and I always see a bit of Celia in her.
Mm. Yeah, there is a real Chris as a calendar girl.
Yes, as opposed to the
opposed to the character Chris. So, but yeah, and I believe that Tim didn't actually meet them until after he'd written the initial script for the film.
Right.
And then, you know, it's funny how much of them he'd captured without knowing them, and how, you know, little bits of their characters. And of course, when they did the next calendar 10 years on, they used elements of the characters that he'd used in the film for their next calendar as well.
Right.
So it's become like a full circle.
The girls and the cast and you lot are going to do a calendar for the show?
Who knows? Wouldn't it be fun?
Wouldn't it be fun?
Talk about the process, because it went to Manchester, which obviously you weren't involved with, Sophie, but Claire, you were.
Yeah, Leeds and Manchester.
And the workshop.
Yeah. Joanna Riding and I, who plays Annie, and I play Chris, we've been involved now for 3 years. It's coming up 3 years for all the workshops. And it's so unusual to be part of something from the very beginning and not get replaced halfway through by somebody off the telly.
Yeah, somebody more famous.
You know.
Or Sophie Louise-Dan.
Yeah, so...
Ouch!
So we're really, you know, it's just been wonderful to be part of it for all this time. And it's just, it feels like we've come home now. It's right. And
well, it certainly feels like I've come home.
Yeah,
I was here last year. My curtains are still in the dressing room.
I know. I did my very, very first London audition here, though, in the days when it didn't used to have much going on. It was for Camelot with Richard Harris. And I came down and auditioned here and got that job.
Nimue.
Yeah. And then here I am, and I've never worked.
See, I'm underscoring your memoir.
Team behind it, because I didn't know that Tim Firth was a composer as well. Mm. I thought it was music by Guy Barlow and lyrics by Tim Firth. And then I saw the Royal Variety performance, and Tim Firth was on the piano.
Yeah.
I thought, what?
Incredible.
So who did, how much of one was done by the other, and
who knows? It's very much a collaboration, and I think they would not. It's a bit like Lennon and McCartney, you know. They stick together, and they always share the plaudits, and so they might know who did what, but
they feed off each other, don't they?
It's such good collaboration, you forget who did what when you hear the end result.
Mm.
And what changed? Can you talk about anything that changed from the north to the south?
Yes, quite a lot of things have changed. I mean. And people who've been to see it, who've seen both versions, have noticed much more in the way of change than I thought they might have, because the changes appeared to me to be quite subtle. The movement of where the interval now is the biggest noticeable change.
Yeah.
And a few other things, and things have been restaged, and there's been nips and tucks, I think.
As there always are,
you know,
in new pieces.
Had work done, hasn't it?
Yeah, exactly. But some small but quite... What is it? Small but quite
impressive
work done. That's exactly what's happened. And so it's pretty subtle, but it has made a massive difference. It's tightened everything up, and it feels right now.
Sophie, you're known for having songs created for you. It happened in Lemmy a Tenor. Did you get to have any? Because you have a massive number, don't you?
Well,
about
I do
your
have
massive
a very, very nice number in Act Two, which there was a chart for it, but I was fortunate enough to, you know, work with Tim, find a little bit of a modulation perhaps, and we worked the front end of the number so that it had a progression and a build, which, as you know, is what I always love to put a stamp on. That is the beauty of doing something original.
And what have the houses been like?
We haven't done a performance yet where they haven't risen as one at the end
of the
show every night.
On their feet. And what is magnificent is to see all these ladies, these groups of ladies. And there are gentlemen there, of course.
Yes.
But it is predominantly groups of ladies having a fabulous night out. And it was interesting. I had a producer friend in last night who said, I was surrounded by ladies who were just sharing their story in the interval. And it was almost like we have an obligation to those people who are investing in this story, but relating to their own.
Mm-hmm.
And I presume people will know the play and possibly the film, because the play was a massive success in London. And what's really nice about this musical is you're not getting that. Apparently they go to America in the original
story. That's right. That's why I'm saying that the denouement finishes in a different place.
And you get
place
a much more moving ending. Could be a sequel.
Well, Girls Too.
And the Girls too. Never Die.
Aww.
Claire, I want to talk to you about your character. Tell us about
Okay. Well, Chris is the driving force behind the calendar. He comes up with the idea. Chris is great for having stupid ideas that she thinks are great ideas. And but on this occasion, she comes up with an idea that Annie takes on as a great idea, and they have a bit of convincing of the other girls to do before it gets taken up. And so she is the push behind it all and getting it all started. And
will the Mrs. Lovett?
Not quite. I hope not.
You can't
with the idea. I hope not. I think the thing about Chris is she sometimes speaks before she engages her brain. But I think she's a generous soul. She adores Annie, and every decision that she makes is putting other people first. I think she's a very selfless woman, actually, which is lovely to play, and obviously very like me. No, but she is, and she creates Annie's barrow of flowers for the calendar, and kind of, oh my God, I haven't done anything for me, and then comes up with what, you know, it's all about other people and trying to keep Annie going, trying to get Annie not to snap out of it, but to move on with her life, which John would have wanted, and the emblem of the sunflower, which is the motif for the show, is so important. It has a journey through the show that John plants the seed.
Yeah.
He asks me to bring the sunflower seeds in for his drink. We follow it through. He writes a speech saying that the sunflower is important to life's pattern. And it is a true motif for the show. And Chris picks up on that, being a florist as well, and follows that through. And in fact, in the real calendar, the sunflower made an appearance on every month. And we wear ours.
We do, as an emblem. Yes.
What I wasn't prepared for was how funny the show is.
Good old Tim Firth.
The witch.
How do you, I mean...
But just playing the truth, that's the key. And what was wonderful in rehearsal, and I think is testament to us as a team, is the camaraderie on and off the stage and through the rehearsal process, because, you know, it's not easy to have a dynamic with multiple women.
Strong women, too.
Strong, feisty women.
You know, we're all
women.
Pretty opinionated.
Yes,
and
but we have absolutely embraced one another, and that is really refreshing.
My husband playing the characters as
it
well.
It does. Well, husband said, you know, it's what happens, you know, off the ball, that is all the nuances, which are so fascinating, which are there by absolute happenstance. Then they're not choreographed in any way. It's how we bounce off each other.
Yeah, well, we really do love and respect each other, and I hope that comes across on stage. Well, obviously, you know, right.
Absolutely. Will we be able to hear any of the songs as we're walking down Oxford Street on our little headphones?
Well, hopefully soon.
I think
that'll be the next thing to think about. There's been a lot going on. You know, we've only just opened.
It's been a while.
And then with the nominations and everything, you know, I honestly can say I haven't had a normal day yet since we started rehearsals. My Christmas things have still not been put away.
I look like
I've been burgled.
My spare room looks like Armageddon.
Yes. Yeah.
I was so thrilled. I was doing my ironing when the nominations came through, but I was doing my ironing.
You see, it's extraordinary. The ordinary becoming the extraordinary. Yeah. I know.
You're ironing a dress for the Olivia.
I was ironing Nick's shirt.
Thank you very much.
Thank
Sophie
you.
Sophie Louise, Dan, and Claire Moore. Good luck with the show tonight and for the rest of its run. May it rain eternal over the
Thank you.
Well, Thoss, it's been lovely to talk to you about the girls, and thank you for the girls for talking about the girls there.
It's easy for you to say.
It is. As I said, do go and see the show. I might even see it again if you fancy going.
I think I might, actually. So it's on at the Phoenix.
It is.
And do we have any idea how long it's on for at the moment? Presumably they're hoping it will be extended.
Forever and ever and ever, I think.
That is always the ambition, isn't it?
Yes.
And indeed, the Phoenix does have a long history of that.
Yes. Blood Brothers. I think they're doing very, very... booking periods, so as not to, you know, kind of to extend everything. But
so you can't buy a ticket now for next Christmas necessarily.
No,
but
do go and buy a ticket now, because it's a jolly good show, as we say,
and jolly good show to that.
Thank you, Thoss.
Monday, 8:10, the 7:30 bus to school is late again, stuck behind a tractor somewhere up the hill. Angry school kids texting don't appreciate the mist that's hovering on the river, but one day you hope they will. Dodge around the truck that drove 10 hours from Amsterdam to Yorkshire, full of flowers.
guy buys the same bouquet a wife had on a wedding day. Thirty Wednesday in the tea shop, the retired headmistress from the infant school tries to beat her husband to the crossword clues. Says hi to the sisters buying flowers for the war memorial. Takes 3 hours to choose the ones they always choose. 7:45 St. Wilfrid's Choir. Try again to handle the Messiah with the sisters who appear and sing too quietly to hear. One more year in Yorkshire. January, February, April, May, September and July. Keep rolling Yorkshire where all the fields are green, the days don't seem to change. The seasons come and go and rise and fall. What will always be the village green, the chip shop tea, the bowls, the bus, the kissing gate, and stepping stones that form the route into the Women's Institute. One year in England, Yorkshire just like Devon, just like March is just like Norfolk and July. North Yorkshire, Norfolk, Suffolk, Kent, West Yorkshire, Cornwall, Shropshire, Devon, Worcestershire, Northumberland. 8 September standing here, same place as we stood last year, and next year we'll be standing on this green and pleasant land to start yet one.
This episode of Musical Talk, copyright 2017, apart from the songs where the copyright persists with the original creators. Welcome to this week's episode of Musical Talk.
This week's coffin. It
wasn't the cough that carried her off, it was a coffin that carried her off in.
Yeah, I like that. I'm going to...
I tried to come up with a pun about pies, but I couldn't. I'm sure you can come up with 25 if I just say come up with a pun about pies.
You're almost taking me for a tart. No, none of this is any good.
It's all a bit flaky.
Yes.